Welcome to MA3D1, the Warwick Maths module on fluid dynamics. This video is about potential flow, general considerations. Here we are going to cover sections 6.1 and 6.2 from the notes. So let's start with the definition of potential flow. A flow is called a potential flow if the velocity field in the flow can be written as the gradient of a single scalar function phi. Here the scalar phi is called the velocity potential. And a necessary and sufficient condition for this to happen, for the velocity to be written as a gradient, is that the vorticity, which you will remember is the curl of velocity, vanishes identically. It's zero everywhere. Okay. This simply follows from vector calculus. You have seen this in the preliminaries and the first example sheet, where you found that the two were equivalent. If velocity is the gradient of a potential, then it becomes really easy to satisfy mass and momentum conservation. Mass conservation simply reads divergence of velocity zero, because we have assumed incompressibility. That gives you just the Laplace equation for the potential, for the velocity potential. And momentum conservation, well, there is a whole separate category of Bernoulli equation which gives you pressure explicitly for potential flow if you know the velocity potential. So the whole problem reduces to solving Laplace equation that satisfies your boundary conditions. If you know the velocity on the boundary, you would need to know the normal component of the velocity on the boundary or the tangential component, then you would need to modify this boundary condition accordingly, but not both. And that is because you have sort of lost the viscous term. The viscous term is automatically accounted for in Bernoulli. If the vorticity is zero everywhere, then the viscous term must not contribute to momentum conservation, and therefore you cannot impose no slip and no penetration simultaneously. This is sort of the sticky point for potential flow in many situations. And we are going to elaborate on this a lot more as we develop this chapter and the rest of this module. But for now, just as the historical development of fluid dynamics happened, let us just pretend that perhaps this is adequate. Perhaps it's okay to satisfy only one and not the other boundary condition. Okay? So let's start examining the consequence of this sort of development. We are mostly going to consider potential flow in two dimensions, two Cartesian dimensions. Perhaps we will consider potential flow in spherical and cylindrical coordinates peripherally as the situation arises. But the most general treatment we are going to make is in two dimensions. Now, it so happens that the treatment is extremely convenient in complex variables. Solving Laplace equation in two dimensions is essentially trivial using complex variables, and this is how you see it. The two conditions that we have are that the vorticity of the flow vanish and the divergence of the flow of the velocity vanish. If I write it down in Cartesian coordinates, the two components of velocity are u and v, and the vorticity is given by this combination of its derivatives, del v del x minus del u del y along the z direction is the vorticity, and that vanishes. I can satisfy this condition trivially by noting that these are the cross derivatives. So I can define u to be the x derivative of some function. It so happens that this function is the same as our velocity potential phi, and v is the y derivative. So if I plug this in to our expression for vorticity, you see del v del x becomes the mixed second derivative of phi, del 2 phi del x del y, and del u del y also becomes the mixed second derivative of phi, and with the minus sign in between, the two cancel and I get a zero trivially. This is really the same statement as the curl of a gradient vanishes identically but in two dimensions. So I haven't said anything special here. But the divergence free condition, which reads del u del x plus del v del y equals zero, this now prompts a similar treatment and another introduction of another scalar variable psi. Now in order to satisfy this condition, I'm going to define u as the y derivative of psi and v as the x derivative of psi, but with a negative sign, so that when I substitute both of these in here, again I get two mixed second derivatives of psi and they cancel each other to give me a zero. Now I have two expressions for the x component of velocity and two for y component of velocity. If I equate them, I get del phi del x is del psi del y. Del phi del y is minus del psi del y, and you will recognize this as the Cauchy-Riemann conditions from complex variables for the real and imaginary parts of a complex function of z equals x plus iy to constitute a holonomic function or an analytic function. And therefore, if you can just write down a holonomic function, and there are like extremely powerful techniques for writing down general holonomic function. Every holonomic function can be written as a power series. And of some kind, and therefore if you write it as a power series, if you write any power series, you can generate holonomic functions pretty much at will, and there and its real and imaginary parts will automatically satisfy the condition for potential flow. There we have it. We would be able to generate a potential flow just by writing down holonomic functions. Now the trick is to satisfy the boundary conditions. So if you can write down the holonomic function that satisfies the boundary condition, you're essentially done. That's going to be our strategy, where we are going to approach it more systematically in section 3.6.3 and 6.4 and so on. So we'll have to wait for that. But in this video, we are going to look at two properties of these scalar functions phi and psi that we have introduced. The first one is that the contours of constant psi are streamlines. Okay, and to see that, let's find the rate of change of psi along a streamline, which means in the direction of the flow. The rate of change of psi, that would be the dot product of del psi del x with u plus del psi del y with v. Now, it so happens that del psi del x is minus v and del psi del y is u, and you see that this expression vanishes, which means psi does not change in the direction of the flow, but a streamline is a curve that's everywhere in the direction of the flow, and therefore psi does not change along a streamline. And because of this, psi is called a stream function. Okay, this is important terminology. We are going to use it again and again. A stream function is everywhere constant along a streamline. Okay. The second property that we are going to see is that of a relation between phi and psi. Contours of constant psi and phi are mutually orthogonal to each other. In order to see that, let's look at the direction along which both phi and psi vary and examine its dot product. So the dot product could be written as del phi del x del psi del x plus del phi del y del psi del y. And you will recognize that this is exactly the same calculation as I have from the previous line. Del phi del x is u, del psi del x is minus v, del psi del x is minus v, and del phi del y is v, and del psi del y is u. And if I add up to zero, that means phi and psi increase along a direction that is mutually orthogonal to each other, and therefore their contours are also, where they intersect, are also mutually orthogonal. We are going to see this in action as we plot, as we look at some examples of potential flow and plot the streamlines. And we are also going to plot the contours of constant phi, the contours of constant velocity potential, just to visualize the flow. So this is a shortish video. This ends the video on the general considerations of potential flow. In the next video, we are going to look at specific flows. I'll see you in that video or in the next live session.